answers, there's a whole variety of things that we can start to think about that would be of benefit to the workforce, and that's great, but primarily of benefit to the patient. Because how many of those appointments, we've got all the numbers in the report here, how many of those appointments are actually filled with people with a clinical or medical need? Because there would be quite a lot of people who probably just need some reassurance that it is actually just a child with a rash and he'd pop into the pharmacy around the corner, you know, that's absolute, you as a new mum just done exactly the right thing. You don't need to bring your child into a practice full of probably quite poorly people and spread it about a bit. So I think, you know, for the protection and help of all of us, you know, thinking about the role of technology and how care can come to you, there was an amazing conference called in Boston 2 weeks ago where this stuff was all over the place, absolutely massively exciting and innovative. And I again, the challenge is because you're moving to a new model of doing things, how can we bring some of that quite brave thinking into play so it quickly becomes our norms? And please don't forget citizens' advice in the model, because our GPs, you know, they basically say 25% of people that they see really need a prescription to citizens' advice and not to anything clinical, medical, or nursing.
So we're doing an awful lot of work on already on teletriage within care homes and looking at telehealth projects, so devices within patients' homes, which means that they can monitor, self-monitor, particularly patients with heart failure, COPD, atrial fibrillation, etc. So we already have teletriage and we're looking at telehealth, and we look at the model from Liverpool and some of the feedback from the work that they've been doing there. Excellent outcomes in terms of patient satisfaction. In terms of reduced appointments, and that's not just easing the load on the GP or on the practice. It means, as you say, the patient doesn't have to come in and sit and wait and see. In terms of addressing and looking at citizens' advice, and a lot of what we see is around social issues, the social prescribers, as part of the primary care networks and the new GP contract, social prescribing is being heralded as certainly going forward, and the aim is that there will be social prescribers within each of the primary care networks going forward. So the other thing that we've been developing, and we have our launch in September, is our World Care Record and Health Information Exchange, which is the sharing of information under the Information Commissioner's Office regulations across our providers, so that our patients only have to tell their story once. How many times have you gone to the doctor and had to say, or you've gone to the hospital having been seen by the GP and tell the same story again? And actually what we have developed and what's currently running is the Health Information Exchange, where consultants within the ED can see what medications, allergies, recent appointments the patient has had within primary care, and likewise we can see within primary care recent things that were done in the hospital, recent investigations. So we are already running and looking at that. And again, that avoids duplication, it avoids frustration in terms of having to repeat things, and it also avoids having the patients having to tell their story over and over again. So we're certainly on that and looking at a lot of stuff. You've got some stories there.
Just to back up what Dr. Cowan said, we've also recently introduced a app that supports the delivery of force prevention risk assessment tools that are individualised. That's been rolled out in care homes. We're going to roll that into the domiciliary care market and other provision. But where that's been applied, that's reduced hospital admissions by 25% in that cohort. So it's kept people in their home, home-like environment, reduced harm. Reduced pressure on A&E, etc. In terms of the neighbourhood delivery model, Age UK and other non-for-profit sector organisations are key partners in that. And Age UK are currently using their personal independence coordinator approach, which again is about supporting people with their activities of daily living, keeping them in their own homes, and brief interventions around things like migration, access to welfare benefits and so on. So we've got a very strong partnership with Community Action Wirral, CAB and other partners in that. And because they're part of those care teams, because go to commissioning approach, we can also access other providers. So some of our social prescribers are the involved Northwest Community Connectors. They are linked to an employment scheme as well, so they're very much focused on some of the more difficult areas, economically, social, difficult areas of our borough, and are actually getting people back into work who have mental health conditions related to worklessness, or have had long-term unemployment because they've had to give up and look after relatives, etc. Their rates of getting people back into employment or into voluntary sector activity are very, very favourable. But also what they do, as they're called connectors, they then connect those people back into their own communities. The evidence by Lynn Friedley and others shows that one good social relationship has 7 years to your life. So that's what we're about. We're about to, the NHS is far too long been in the silo, health and care is far too long been in the silo. 5 year forward view, 10 year plan, whatever you think about them, it's a changing thinking, and actually it's a changing thinking because over the years we realised we can only affect 10% of people's health and care. That's what the rest actually we have to work with our partners and work with those communities, and you know, organisations don't change, people do, and that we just have to give them the ability to do it. So there's lots of examples we've got in Wirral that are beyond the scope of urgent care, consultation and review. And that's because of the work we've done locally with rural people.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Chair. I think it's a great idea that we are using our highly skilled AHPs a lot more than we have done in the past. It's too long now that this could be left in the background and nobody's ever used them. But you have made a lot of talk about using GPs and the fact that you have the capacity for GPs. One of the things I would like to know is, in terms of numbers, the demographics, how many are due for retirement in the next 5 years? How many work part-time?
Cheshire and Merseyside network of gender identity specialists, which would be physician associates supporting GPs. There are more pharmacists now undertaking prescribing courses, so actually we have pharmacists supporting GPs. And what we're again looking at is what's the broader role of pharmacists in terms of the community pharmacist is a clinician in a shop, not a shopkeeper, so we've got that as one of the routes there, but also how do clinicians, clinical pharmacists support GPs in their prescribing behaviours, but also how do they start to treat people who are coming through the practice's door again, with low-level conditions but may need a bit of extra prescribing support. And actually some of those clinical pharmacists also are starting to specialise in areas such as mental health, so my partner currently doing her prescribing course, specialising in mental health conditions. So we're getting a different start of skill set in. So the GP role is starting to change to more of a coordinator of care, a coordinator of population health management. And they will have far more people around them in those multidisciplinary teams on an equal level to call upon. And as I said, it's about us breaking down that barrier about who's within that team. It is actually the whole community as part of that team.
To the debate around new technology. And I'm just a little bit concerned regarding the whole transport issue, the new technology, and the effect that will have on patients who are financially challenged. So my concerns really are we giving the best service? I'm just seeing in this paragraph A, with the transport aim of providing the best service. Is that the best service we can do moment, or would that make the service worse for some people, better for others, you know, given them financial pressures on particular socio-economic groups? So until they say it's going to be apps on the phone and all the rest of it, but a phone costs you £30 a month, doesn't it, you know, to get the internet and all the rest of it. So all the way through this, my concern is that we don't make the service worse for any single person who's affected cumulatively by the impacts of poverty. And you mentioned it before, you know, regarding the 12-year gap between rural south, rural west, and other areas. So it's just that best service for who? Best service for everyone, or best service for a few?
Yeah, and absolutely, and what my colleague was talking about earlier was that everything that we do, we need to do an impact assessment on, and that we have to review, because we can't on Wirral allow the people in south and west to flourish even more whilst we're disadvantaging the other side of the motorway. So absolutely, our responsibility as a commissioner is to try and tackle those health inequalities, not to make them worse. So everything that we do equality impact assessments, and that social, the deprivation that we have, the levels of deprivation here. We've had a colleague join us recently from Nolan, and he was surprised. He said they've always used the trunk card at Nolan, asking, we're the worst in the country. But he says you have homes here that are the worst in the country, and he was surprised. So that's something that as commissioners we are obliged to absolutely will be looking at over with.
The use of technology in terms of mobile phone apps isn't for everybody. We fully recognise that. In the same way as as part of the digital work we're doing around rural care record health information exchange, the patient portal where patients can access their results from the hospital online isn't for everybody. So what we have to ensure is that whatever we do aims to cover our population, and that it's an equitable delivery of service. So an app may be very appropriate. COPD app that you can have on your phone for patients with COPD. It's great if somebody has an iPhone or a smartphone, but not everybody does. So we have to sometimes refer to paper, which is still okay. And it's about getting that mix. And not just, as I said, not just going for an app because it's a younger patient. You know, some of our older patients are happy with that, but it's making sure that what we do covers all of our patients and actually that they're all able to access whatever it is that needs to be accessed in the most appropriate way for them. So, you know, recognising that we have significant areas of deprivation here, and we're recognising, as I mentioned earlier, that age discrimination and length of lifespan, etc., across Wirral, we have to tackle that. Because in 2019, saying that there's a 12-year difference between in a 15-mile radius is wrong. And actually, our population health work, using our data now around where there's high areas of deprivation, where there's high areas, where there's COPD, where there's high areas, where there's smoking, etc., we have to hone in on those particular areas and say, how can we do things better? And that's why when we looked at the data, and when we looked at the feedback that we got, actually adding those 2 extra hours of work is really important, because there's such high areas of deprivation in that one, in that part of Wirral. So we need to, whilst we want to be equitable across everything, we need to really recognise that. But on the west side of Wirral, as you mentioned earlier, Councillor Jordan, or at the last meeting, there are patients living in very isolated, big houses out in the countryside who actually can't get out of their house because they're elderly and they can't get transport. So there are different needs, despite the socioeconomic differences, and we have to look at all of those. We have to get better looking at them. We have to work with them on how we do it.
Any further questions? I just have one, and it takes us right back to what underpins all of this, and how this all began. Because you talked a lot about the extensive consultations, but actually, they were about the model and ETC we were going to have. They were not consultations about the principle of whether there was one. And I would be really interested to know how much consultation went into that original decision to have a ETC.
Okay, so yes, the decision to cite the UTC, that's kind of a part of the was made during February this year by the governing body. I think in the appendices that have been shared, you go back on the aging care consultations for a considerable time, way before my time, right back to, so it was 2009, but I think the last 2 to 3 years it's been much more extensive in terms of stakeholder events, workshops, etc. The UTC was clearly a mandated direction of travel by NHS England, but when you look at the reasons for wanting to introduce an urgent treatment centre, there's nothing in the documentation that I'm sure anyone could argue, because this was about an attempt to standardise urgent care, to improve access, to have a consistent offer for people, and actually really improve urgent care right across the country. And I think what was reflected in that report was what was mirrored to us locally in Wirral, which was there was confusion. There was a myriad of slight variation of services with different opening hours, offering slightly different things with different levels of professionals in there. And we mirrored in Wirral the national picture. So we were working locally, we were all asked as systems to introduce urgent treatment centres to improve urgent care and access in the offer, but we were asked to look at the local context. And actually there were 2 decisions to make, which was around, do you site an urgent treatment centre and co-locate it with the acute hospital, or do you provide them in the community? And different systems have looked at their local position and deliberated the best thing with their local contact and where they were. And that's what we've gone away to do, and that was why that recommendation, following some significant work with stakeholders across the system, including lay patients, health watch, etc., what why that recommendation was made to government body. Thank you.
Any further questions?
not satisfied that the consultation with the relevant health scrutiny arrangements or any proposal has been adequate, or if the committee does not consider that proposals would be in the interests of the health service in its area. Obviously, if you were minded to make a referral, then there is the requirement to notify the health service as to when you would be minded to make that referral, the date that you would be minded to make that referral, so that they could enter into negotiations with us in relation to any comments or recommendations that, you have. I think the committee has, in a sense, already made recommendations and comments when we met previously, and obviously the Wirral Opioid Scrutiny Committee has made various comments in the recommendations that were passed last week. This committee might also want to make further recommendations, even if you don't want to refer the matter to the Secretary of State.
Works for the NHS.
the options of services, and the first one being confusing. I don't see what's changed with that, because there's so many options available, options for what I consider to be the worst socially economic affected people in Rockferry and Morton have been reduced. So that walk-in minor injury facility is no longer available. So we have had an enhancement of services in other parts, in Wirral West and Wirral South, but in the parts, I'm sorry, Birkenhead, and has had enhancements. But my concern is it's just one person's health provisions made worse, and I think it will be by taking away the walk-in facility. I find it difficult to accept this, and I can't see why the walk-in facility in Gladstone and in Morton can't continue. I'm not really convinced about, if you walk in Gladstone and Morton, you'd have to wait a lot longer than what if you made an appointment. And I couldn't see any improvements along with Councillor Jordan regarding the transport facilities, because if you've got a minor injury and you want to walk straight in and get immediate attention, you can't anymore in these two treatment centres. You have to travel to either Birkenhead or Eastham or Hyde Park, and we've already heard that transport provision is reducing. No one's got any control over that, only the Liverpool City region as we stand. So I'm still thinking that certain people that we've talked to tonight, the worst economically affected people, because things aren't getting any better with austerity, they're getting worse. We now could be going into, God knows what, which is going to make people's lives worse, and if people's lives are worse, it's that cumulative impact which makes people more vulnerable to illness, and more vulnerable to both mental illness and physical illness. And we're seeing people on the streets, where's the provision for them? So reducing any sort of provision at the moment, and all this talk about the digital apps and all the rest of it, in my opinion, will lead to a reduction in service, because that to a certain extent is about saving money, isn't it?
Obviously, if you do, you have a problem with transport.
equity assessment that in theory the numbers seem to be higher than they were under the original proposal. So that's sort of for me. I think the challenge for all of us, and Councillor Jordan again has just sort of repeated what said what I was going to say, it comes down to the quality of that experience for the patients in those areas that we just sort of talked about, like Ferry and Horton and places that I'm afraid I don't know at all, but obviously you guys do. And I think there is such an opportunity, if they are going to be coming back to your health scrutiny committee, and I would perhaps say 6 months, 12 months would be a good opportunity to have a look at some of those changes that have been made and what people's perception of those are. Because where there are, you know, sort of elements of, you know, sort of very significant deprivation, you know, it is not necessarily the clinical services that are missing from that area, it's all of the other things. So if when you are in your GP practice, you know, there is a mechanism that ensures that you are claiming every benefit that you are entitled to claim, you know, because how many people do we all speak to who might be on all sorts of benefits but the kids aren't getting free school dinners? Because nobody's thought to say, and you would be eligible for, of people actually claiming and accessing all the things that the council has on offer, that all the partners involved in the health and wellbeing of our citizens have on offer, but people just don't know about them because you've got to go to the council for this, or the trust company for that, or the GP for this, or the walking centre for something else, or you might actually just walk into somebody in the post office that knows. I think that is the challenge, and that might be something that you can really hone in on those sort of 6 monthly health checks as to what goes forward from here.
Scrutiny committee and the members who served on the transport group.
that vote.